the Arati song being sung as we do in all our centers. May I ask Juma to please sing the first four verses?
Yes, Maharaj. Khandano bhavo bandhano jago bandhano bonditomai niranjano naro rupo dharo niranjano naro rupo dharo nirguno guno mai mochano agho dushano jago bhushano chidghano kai Gyananjano bimalo nayono Gyananjano bimalo nayono Bhikshane mohojai Bhasharo bhavo Rasagaro chiro unmado premo pathar bhaktar jano jugalo charono bhaktar jano jugalo charono Tarano bhavo par jrimbito jugo isharo jago disharo jogo shahai nirodhano Shamahito mano nirodhano Shamahito mano nirokhitabo kripa.
Thank you, Juma, for nicely singing. See, this song, as we saw in our previous weeks, this stotra was written by Swami Vivekananda himself. So we saw that how the history of this stotram, how it came up, and we have completed studying these four stanzas. So today we have to start with fifth stanza. The fourth stanza, you'll find Niraki Tava Kripai, with that it ends. Niraki means I do see. I see by your grace. What I am saying, that you are the Supreme Lord of the universe. That is what I see. Jagadishwara. That's what I see. You are the Supreme Lord of the universe. You have come down as an incarnation of this age. And then you are here to help us. We are the seekers of liberation. You are here to help us. That is one view, I said. Another meaning is, by your grace, subduing my mind, Nirodhana Samahitamana, that we saw that, we explained that, subduing my mind, concentrating on you, Samahitamana, I am able to see you. Either both the types of meanings are accommodated in this verse. So our elder Swamijis in the olden days, they used to explain that you can interpret in both the ways. The first is that I see you as the supreme, etc., etc., all the adjectives you can provide, or by your, I see you, that you, by your grace, I'm able to see yourself. So these are the two types of interpretation we saw. So today we shall pass on to the fifth verse, Bhanjanam. Can you please sing?
Yes. Bhanjana dukha ganjana karuna ghana karma kathor pranarpana jagata tarana pranarpana jagata tarana krentana kalido.
Yes, thank you. So the first line you see, bhanjana dukha ganjana karuna gana karma kator. Except bhanjana, the other three words are all combination of two words. What are the two words? Dukha ganjana, but written together. Likewise, karuna ghana. So karuna ghana is also one word. And then karma kator. This is also karma kator. So in this way, we find that unless we could connect with the meaning of the previous verse to the next verse, it will not be very clear why Swamiji is bringing bhanjana dukha ghanjana. What is the meaning? The word meaning is bhanjana means breaker or destroyer. Dukha means sufferings. Ghanjana means which is despicable or detestable or which I don't like. That is called ghanjana. Ghanjana, dukha ghanjana, the sufferings that I do not like, those type of sufferings are all broken or destroyed by Sri Ramakrishna's grace. So he is calling Sri Ramakrishna as bhanjana. You are the destroyer. But what you destroy? You don't destroy the cities. You don't destroy the people. You destroy the dukkha ganjana, the despicable form of the miseries. You destroy those miseries. Now we shall see how these miseries come to us. You know, Vedanta has got, of course, we say that proudly, we say it has got answers to all questions. So even if you say that this world is something very tremendous thing is happening, you say, no, it's all right, it's all Maya. Don't worry about that. So you can always bring some type of answers. So how the miseries come to us has been analyzed in our Vedanta. What do they say? There are two sources of getting misery. One is karma and bhavana. Karma is action, bhavana is your thought. So if I think something bad to somebody, that has to produce, that has to come back to me as dukkha. In the same way, karma, as I do some action, if I harm somebody, if I do something bad to someone, that also will come back to me in the form of an action. So these karma and bhavana are the two sources of getting our miseries. Suppose you say, if you do good things and if you think good thoughts, will that bring miseries? No. That will bring pleasure. That will bring you some sukha. So sukha, these two are the sources for sukha and dukkha. This sukha and dukkha are, of course, coming one after another. Why? Because we are doing like that. Our karmas and our bhavanas are like that. In our normal, ordinary life, sometimes I ask our devotees, whole day, 24 hours, if you take it, how many times we might have done something which will harm others? Or how many times you would have thought of doing harm to others? Today only I was discussing with one of our devotees that spider, you know, spider tries to make its own houses. So where does it make? It comes into your room. And when here in all the corners, if the spider is making, you are afraid. Suppose you have a just born baby or a small child is there in your home. So he may be, that child may be affected. So you are very particular that no spider web should be there within your living room. So what you do, you remove that. So you think before removing, before bringing the action, you think how to remove that. Should I spray? Should I put something so that the spider is killed? So one devotee came to me the other day and said, Maharaj, I can remove every spider by, you know, that Henry, that we got a Henry machine. It's a vacuum cleaner. So you put that vicious pipe and then you suck it and all the spiders will go into that. And then they all will dead. No, I said, no, I don't want to remove the spider from my room and to get it death. Death is not its penalty. Can you take it out and then put it out? So that is what I told him. Even thinking that the spider has to be killed is a thought. A thought that is going to harm another jiva. The spider, mind you, it may be small. Or if it touches your body, it may create some reactions, allergic reactions on your body. You'll have to suffer for that. But then that is also a jiva. Some jiva is sitting in that body form of spider. So when you start thinking bad, thinking harmful to that spider, you are incurring a sin. Now, this is what happens. So, yes, anybody? I saw somebody's raising question. No, okay. So these miseries come to us either by our actions in this birth or by our thoughts in this birth, or from where we are getting these miseries. And you may say, I have not done anything wrong in this birth. I have led a very beautiful life. I have not thought also any bad thing. Still I am getting miseries. Yes, these miseries are traced to the previous life. So Vedanta accepts the Punarjanmavad, that is the reincarnation theory. What is the reincarnation theory? Every jiva, every soul that is within the body has to take another birth, another birth, another birth, till it finally reaches its destination of moksha. So moksha is the ultimate goal of human life. There are four kinds of purusharthas. What are they? Dharma, artha, kama, moksha. And moksha is the ultimate destination. If all the three, dharma, artha and kama, are synchronized or aligned with the goal of moksha, then you are advised to cultivate all the three so that moksha path becomes easier. So these miseries, I don't like. Anybody does like misery? In the whole of Indian literature, this spiritual literature, I'm telling you, only one person we found who says to the Lord, oh Lord, give me miseries. Who is that? Yes? Yes, Juma?
Kunti.
Kunti, yes. Kunti Devi. She is the only person we find asking Lord Sri Krishna, please give me miseries after miseries so that I can remember you. There is another person in the world who wanted miseries in the Western world.
Saint
John the Cross. Anybody remembers?
Saint John of the Cross.
Yes. Can you tell? What did he ask?
Maybe Dharmat can say. Dharmat.
Oh, Dharmat, can you say? Saint John the Cross is another person like Kunti who wanted miseries after miseries. Why he wanted miseries from God?
So actually he wanted to be like people should condemn him and he should be in a despicable position so that his egos can be totally crushed.
Yes, yes. His ego was such a big, he thought that ego has to be crushed. So how can I crush my ego unless people come and vilify me and, you know, and character assassination if they do, let them do. I want that. Oh Lord, give me sufferings more and more so that my ego becomes small and small and small. So likewise, yes.
A few sentences back, you said that even the thought of killing an animal or a jiva is not correct. And then there is an example of Bhagavad Gita, whom that lady had sent that brahmachari to learn, and whose profession was to kill animal and earn the living, and yet he learned the highest of the philosophy. So how is that perceived?
Yes, that killing is not out of the feeling that I don't like this, I don't want it. That killing as a profession, he's supplying food. You know, these animals, these birds, these are all consumed by human beings. So what happens? These have to be caught and then killed. So there are several butcheries are available, you find, to kill the animals. So even horse meat is eaten. In Ireland, horse is considered as a wealth, as we used to consider the buffaloes and cows as wealth in India. Likewise here also cattle is wealth. So horses are also wealth. But then some people eat horse meat. So naturally the old horses are sold out and then they are cut. Now the person who does the cutting, does he do harm to that? No. He is not willing by mind that I must kill this horse. He is doing as his profession. If he does as a profession, he is relieved from the sin of killing. That's why the butchers, they are all protected by the dharma. How the dharma comes and protects them? It is because they don't want to kill an animal just because of the taste of that animal. No. You see, previously the kings used to go for, in the jungles, and then they would hunt. This hunting is a game. So for game, for pleasure purpose, you kill somebody, then it is a sin. Yes, Subhash, you can unmute and then ask.
Yes, Pranam Maharaj.
Hi, Namaskar.
So from that, what you said about an animal. So yes. When I offer flowers in the morning, I see ants sometime, and I kill them right away or sometimes I see they are climbing on Thakur's picture. Mm. And then I go and kill. So is that a sin then, committing a sin?
Yes, I should say it is. Why I'm telling you? The reason is, why can't you, if you don't want ants in your photos, can you not stop the source of the ants coming? In our ashram here, 1.5 years before, I'm telling you, from the outside, the roadside door is there. One door, we have roadside door within the shrine. In that door, we found hundreds and hundreds of ants accumulating. And now children are coming to the ashram, and if the ants bite the children, what will happen? So we have to be very careful. So to protect the people who visit our ashram, we have to close that source. So the ants do not enter there. We put a sheet like, so that the ants cannot enter. Now, such steps we have to take instead of killing it. But then, since it has come inside, since you do not want to, get it a problem, so you want to kill it, you are killing. But then what happens, what I'm telling you, even if you tap on your palm and kill a mosquito, it is killing. The definition cannot be changed, you see. Killing it is. And your intention is to kill the mosquito. Your intention is to kill the ant, then definitely it is a sin. You have to get some type of karmic effect for that. Though you cannot hide yourself into the glorious event of that I am doing puja, so no sin should come. No. That's why in the end, beta apavitra pavitrova, like that we say that in the beginning. Likewise, the end also, janata ajanatova. Whether I am knowledgeable or not knowing also, if I do any mistakes, please excuse me. He said that. So that sin does not accumulate, but karmic action will come. Now here is one question. What is the difference between the result of the karmic action and what you call sin? In Sanskrit, it is called papa. Papa and punya. You know, this actually confuses us whether the papa and punya are something along with the action or not. As I told you, whenever we perform any action, that action is induced and the sourced by the thought. Only after the thought, the action can come. If the thought is not there, no action can come. So the action is preceded by a thought. The thought will create its own reactions. If the thought is good, it will create punya. If the thought is bad, it will create papa. Yes?
Saying that every karma begins with the thought.
With the thought.
Okay.
First, it must start with the thought.
So that's when our karma begins from that point of thinking only.
Thank you. Yes.
Okay.
I think that I need water. Then I go and bring water and drink. The drinking part is karma. But I thought that I need water. That is the thought.
Okay. And suppose if I'm just thinking but not acting on my thoughts.
Yes, you may. You may think and you may not act. That is possible.
So then what happens if I'm thinking bad thoughts?
That's what I'm coming now.
Okay.
What I'm coming to. So in every action which is preceded by a thought creates a reaction, a result. The result is, if it is a good thought, it will be called punya. If it is a bad thought, it is called papa. So you are incurring punya or papa according to the basis of your thoughts. Now, separate it from the action. Most of our times, our actions and thoughts seems to be together. See, when I do a work, I do not say that thought came yesterday, so I am doing today. No, I just go and sit on that dining table and start eating. But where was the thought? Thought was not yesterday. Thought was now only. But the source is thought, due to which I am now sitting at the dining table. So there is a clear distinction in the shastras they make, the thought and the action. These two may be together going, okay. But the two must be there. But a thought can remain alone without any action. But no action can remain without the thought. So now whatever the result of thought is considered as punya and papa. So merit and demerit. This is what the word we use in English. For papa, we call it demerit, not sin. Mind you, the sin word is not used for papa. It's called demerit. And then for punya, it is merit. This merit and demerit are accumulating. It is not like points. If you are a good student in your class, then the teacher gives you for that good behavior, good, etc., say 10%. Yes, Jody?
Om Maharaj, thank you. Yes. While Maharaj was talking, I was wondering how this concept of shares and prayers is part of what you are talking about. And also, what I wanted to know is, can a thought exist without a sound? Because in this idea of sound, thought and action, I think is part of Vedanta.
Yes, yes. Of course, that goes in a very detailed way. So I don't think we'll have time for that today. But I will take up that another time, okay? But there is a thought and action, do you understand or not? It's clear. Thought and action is clear.
Now, yes, Maharaj, it's very clear. Yes, that's okay. Very clear.
Okay, then you see, so what I'm coming here is the action we do. So now I have thought I will kill a spider. And now I take really some spray and kill all the spiders in my room. That is an action. So there was a thought, there was an action. This action will bring me one result. Whatever result it becomes, that result will come to me. But then what happened to the thought? thought will accumulate as papa. This punya and papa, so there is a concept in Hinduism that after the death, the subtle body goes to different swarga or different naraka. There are different types of swargas are there. Likewise, there are different types of narakas are there, where you suffer or you enjoy. So the soul goes there and enjoys in the heaven. So why, how can a soul go to the heaven and enjoy what? It enjoys the good thoughts, reactions, that is, which has come to it as merits, as punya. Kshine punya martyalokam vishanti, Sri Krishna says in Gita. Once the punya is become kshina, once it becomes very lean and thin, that is, it is disappearing, it is enjoyed fully, then you come back to earth. And in earth, what will catch you? The result of your action will now come to you. The result of your thought, as already you have enjoyed in the heavens. And now the result of action will come to you as a good birth or as a very comfortable life, etc., etc. Yes, Dermot?
Maybe this is a stupid question, but...
No question is stupid, please. Ask confidently.
But even in a punya, you know, a thought that achieves merit, is there not something sort of egoic about that? If the thinker or the doer is doing an action that is good, but he or she is doing it from the point of view of like, I will get something for myself out of this, you know, in the future. Is that not in a way strengthening the ego in a way?
Yes.
I can understand socially that it's good that people do good actions, you know, for the control of society and harmony between people.
Yes.
But like from a spiritual point of view, does it not, you know, if you're doing things for merit, does that not, are you not in a way sort of spiritually selfish?
No. See, if you do for others any good actions, thinking that you will get good merits in the next life, you are welcome to do it. Yeah. In what way it is bad for him? Unmute.
Yeah, sorry. It's just that you're just thinking of yourself, you know, of your own.
Yes.
Of making things good for yourself in the future.
That is how people are propelled to actions. Normally, 99% of the population is propelled in actions, thinking of good things I will get later.
Yes.
For me, I will enjoy, I will get it, like that only. Mm-hmm. But then only by experience they learn, no, this selfish life is not the actual life. It is only I have to live for others. I have to live for the society. These ideas comes later after getting some thrashes by the nature. Nature will give you thrashes, as Swamiji says. Yes. So what I was telling, yes, regarding Papa and Punya, yes. Unmute, please.
Subhash wants to say, Subhash's iPad, there's a hands up from a long time.
No, she already asked and finished. Oh. Please put up that hand, yes.
What is her name? We call her as Subhash, I think. She's... You are talking on mute.
My name is Shubhra, and this is my husband's iPad, so it comes as Subhash.
Okay, no problem, Shubhra. Now you see, likewise, as I told you about this papa, the punya, likewise the papa also comes. So the scriptures call it, the Puranas say, if you have bad thoughts thought out in your life, those things will get accumulated as papa, and to suffer this papa, you, after your death, your soul will go to different narakas. So they are called hells. And once you finish all those experiences in the hell, you will have to come back to this earth. What for? Because those bad thoughts are over now. Now, bad actions you have done, the results where they will go. So they are all waiting as a Sanchita Karma Phala. So they are called Sanchita. They are all accumulated karmic effects. They are sitting, waiting for you. So that you can experience the sufferings. Now these sufferings, nobody likes, you know. I also don't like, you also don't like. None likes these sufferings. So this is dukkha. This dukkha is ganjana. I dislike these sufferings. So whatever sufferings I dislike, see, Ramakrishna is there for me to remove, to destroy those sufferings. How you can remove like that? Because an avatara purusha, if you pray to God, that's why the God prayer is very essential. Praying to God every day is essential because he can remove the power to remove some of the papa reactions. The papa can be reduced to zero by the God's grace. Though not the effect of your action, that you have to, of course, suffer. But then the papas can be burnt. So by the grace of God and by the grace of great holy men, if the holy men also give you that type of ashirvad, you know, blessings, then your papa can be removed. That's why it is said, bhanjana, dukkha ganjana. And then you shall go to the next one.
Before
the next one, next is karuna ghana. Now, why should Lord be so interested in removing your miseries?
Just before you start this topic, Maharaji, just the two examples where Thakur gives to Swami Yogananda and Balaram Bose. And yes. One case is he asked to who was only Balaram Bose was not in favor of killing those insects and all these things. But initially he never saw, and later one day he saw Thakur cleaning his bed and then killing the bed bugs. Mm. And then it was some kind of other animal that he asked.
Cockroach, I think.
Yeah. And to kill, and he left it in the garden, something, and got a scolding from that.
Yes.
What are those perspectives?
That perspective is Sri Ramakrishna, that perspective you have to take it as a Sri Ramakrishna as a guru. When guru gets his disciples, the guru looks into the disciples' deep psychic activity. What is he thinking? How is his behavior, etc.? Sometimes, you know, the disciples go to such an extent to even in the boat, there was a talk vilifying the character of Sri Ramakrishna by some people. So one disciple was listening to that. And then he came and told the Gurudev. And then Guru Maharaj said, what is it? You kept quiet. You didn't oppose them. And another disciple wanted to drown the boat itself because they were talking ill of Sri Ramakrishna. And Sri Ramakrishna said, no, you can't do this. Why then? What that boatman has done wrong to me? He did not speak about bad to me. So why do you want to drown him also? So he put the question to him. So it is putting the perspective that a guru has to find out the disciples' lacuna or lacking in what activity or what ideals or what traits, and that he will fill it up. So that is why guru does that as an experiment. So that the disciple understands it. Yes.
Maharaji, what Malavika said about Thakur killing the bed bugs. So why was he killing the bed bugs? How will you explain that? If you just now said that you should not kill the ants.
No, I'm telling that he was teaching Balaram Bose.
Okay. All right.
Yes.
In that.
Yes. So the next we are going, Karuna Gana. So the question comes, he is personified compassion. So he is personified means what? That is embodied compassion. If compassion has got a form, and that form is Sri Ramakrishna, that you find that even though Sri Ramakrishna has killed the cockroach and asked his disciple to kill it, etc., but you'll find that he was completely compassionate. And this compassionate is this because of his compassion, he is ready to remove your sufferings. This dukkha, bhanjana, this work he is doing out of compassion to the jivas. So an avatara always does this. Any great saint does this to remove the sufferings from the devotees. So he does this. Why he does this? What prompts him to make, to do this action of removing the dukkha? That is compassion from the guru. So he says karuna gana and karma kathor. Karma kathor means kathor karma. Bhauti kathor karma karta, like that we say that, no? That means very strenuous activities he does. You know, Sri Ramakrishna's strenuous activities, you'll find it's very interesting. You know, when we say compassionate, we find in the earlier avatars like Sri Ram and then Sri Krishna, how they were compassionate to many people. You know, Ram was very compassionate to Guha, and Ram was very compassionate to Sabari. You find all these type of examples are there. Krishna was very compassionate to Kubja, that Kubja woman, you know, who came to Sri Krishna and fed him some sweetmeats. And he was very compassionate to her. And likewise, then to, and his own friend, Sudama, how he was compassionate. Like this, there are several examples are there. In Buddha's case also, we find the stories how he was compassionate to the swan and the lamb, etc. So in all the great men, we find their compassion is something extraordinary. And they go out of the way to show the compassion to the people. So in the same way, Sri Ramakrishna showed his compassion to one Rasik. Rasik was a sweeper in the Dakshineswar Kali temple. And how Sri Ramakrishna gave compassion to him, most of us know because we are all devotees. We have read about his life. So compassionate to Rasik and to the others. Even though Girishchandra Ghosh says, I am a sinner. Oh Lord, I cannot come and touch you also. But then Sri Ramakrishna embraces him and tells him, no, no. He is so full of compassion to Girish Ghosh. And he made him so pure. So later days, you know, Girish Ghosh lived a very pure life, though his past was very bad. But then you see, so he became a saint. So that's how the compassion of Lord works on everybody. And you can see that at the time of death of the Rasik, the sweeper, Sri Ramakrishna had told him, yes, I will come and take you. And exactly Rasik says, all others have come and the body was brought on a cot, you know, on a taped cot. And then his body was there. And Rasik is telling, Sri Ramakrishna has come. He has come to take me. I'm going with him. Others could not see, of course, master, but then he could see. So he promised him, at the last moment, I will come and take you. So he did that. So this compassionate nature gives Sri Swami Vivekananda to call his master as Karuna Gana, embodied, compassion embodied. That is what he calls him. And also this, and Karma Kathor, very, very arduously he spends his activities. He is not taking rest. He is always on the work. What type of work Sri Ramakrishna was doing? So it is very interesting to see. In Kali temple, he was a pujari. From pujari level, he rose to a Paramahamsa there. Even though he became Paramahamsa and all the actions were taken away from him by Mother Kali, still he was working. What was the work he was doing? Meeting people and raising the higher divine consciousness in each person whom he met. In everyone, whoever came to him, he roused the divine consciousness, the Chaitanya, he roused. So whoever came to him felt blessed. Ah, what a wonderful it is that we have gone. So this Karma Kator, he did a lot. You know, if you say his life from the sadhanas, if you take also, the various sadhanas he did for the whole span of his life while staying at Dakshineswar temple, is surprising. You know, the Leela Prasanga is a book where the details of his sadhanas are written down by Swami Saradananda. Sri Sri Ramakrishna Leela Prasanga. It was translated into English as Sri Ramakrishna, the great master. We used to read this book and used to get always stunned, you know, what type of sadhanas he did not do. And all these sadhanas are very kator sadhanas. Karma kator is absolutely suitable to him. So much of sadhanas he did. Roma Rola says, it is very, very rarely seen one person doing so much of sadhana, which is done by a whole generation of a country. If the whole of India, all the population of the India, one crore population in his time, have done sadhanas, that put together in one life, Sri Ramakrishna has done. It is something tremendous sadhanas. So that itself shows that Karma Kator. This Karma Kator was going on physically till he did the Shodashi Puja, mind you. Once he did the Shodashi Puja, on that day, he offered everything. All his karma phala also he offered to at the feet of Holy Mother Sri Sarada Devi. After that, no more physical action for him. He became a Paramahansa. And after that, only these mental actions were there. That also went on till his last day, final day at Kashipur. At Kashipur, he was lying on the sick bed, unable to speak because of the throat cancer. Still, devotees, the boys are sitting next to him. He's speaking to them. And elderly devotees come, like Balram Bose, or the other elderly devotees, when they come, they tell Sri Ramakrishna, don't speak now. Don't speak now. Give rest to your throat. And when they go out, then he starts speaking again to the disciples. Till last moment, he had such a tremendous work output he did. That's why he's called Karma Kator, very aptly said. This Karma Kator, this type of spending his life, very hard working, that also has got a purpose. How did he do it? He did it by sacrificing himself, one or little by little. That sacrifice in his life is the reason for which he could do so much hard work. So that adjective Swami Vivekananda now brings, pranarpana. He brings that idea, pranarpana. Arpan means offering. Prana means your life force. That life force he has given. He did not mind. Okay, let the body go, but I shall speak now to my disciples. So that prana arpana, the life force was surrendered or offered in doing a hard, very hard work. So this life force, prana arpana, is a very beautiful word, you know. In Purusha Suktam, in Rigveda, we find how the divine cosmic energy sacrificed itself and in the form of creating this universe. This universe was not just created in an easy way. So the Purusha Suktam says that the Lord, the Narayana, he sacrificed his whole life, his whole body, his entirety. He sacrificed. That means, sacrifice means we are simply thing, something we put on the agni, you know, on the fire. Not that sacrifice is meant. The sacrifice of offering yourself as a root cause for this entire universe. When Lord has become the cause of the universe, the Lord is now sacrificed at the altar for creating this universe. So that is the sacrifice concept comes from very, very ancient times. From the Rigvedic times it comes. So the process of creation itself is a sacrifice of Lord. The Lord has become this universe. And while becoming this universe, he has sacrificed himself completely. So that is how, so that the world can smoothly work. Now you see, such noble sacrifices are not unknown to us. I will tell you, Nivedita, who hailed from Ireland, she chose for India's regeneration one symbol. Everybody said, asked Nivedita, you wanted India to become freedom, to have freedom, India to have freedom. Then what symbol would you give to the Indians? She drew a symbol. And what was that symbol, you know? It was a symbol of Dadichi Muni's bones. She said, this is what I want to do. What did Dadichi Muni did? Dadichi Muni, once he was doing tapasya, and he was nearing completion of tapasya, and he would have merged with God. He was an Advaitic Vedantin, you know. He was not a Dvaitin. He would have just merged in supreme consciousness. That Dadichi, at that moment, Indra comes and serves him as his disciple. And then one day, Indra says, oh, Maharishi, you will leave your body, but before that, I would like to have a request to you. Okay, what do you want? He said, I want your backbone. What are you going to do? I'm going to make a weapon from your backbone, and that weapon will be called Vajra. That Vajra, I will use it to kill a demon. Then Dadichi Muni says, hey, Indra, though you have not come to me as Indra, and in somebody's form you came, and then you learned everything from me, and then you did good service to me, but you did not have done all these things. You could have straight away come to me and asked for my backbone. I would have given immediately. You already wasted your 34 years in serving me. That was not necessary. So Nivedita says, what a mind of Dadichi, you say. He says, you could have asked me just like that. I would give my life for another person. Only this is what you wanted. Take it. And he sat in meditation and he left his body. And then once his prana went off from his body, Indra cut his body and took the backbone and made the Vajra. Vajra is a four-side weapon, you know. It is not two-side weapon. Four-side, it has got very sharp angle is there. And with that weapon, he killed the devil. For the good of these devatas, if you ask somebody for the good of public, so I'm coming to Dermot's question, for the benefit of the society, if somebody wants from you, this is not actually, Indra did not kill Dadichi Muni, but he only requested him, can you spare your backbone? So Dadichi Muni granted the backbone. And with that, he made a weapon. And for the protection of this world, Indra used. So you see, the sacrifice is a very, very basis of our life. Actually, we do not understand that we are doing so much of sacrifice in our own lives. I tell our householder devotees, how much sacrifice you do. It is not very easy to get up early morning and cook for the monks and bring it here and go to office and then work there for 8 hours and then come back. It's not easy. You sacrifice your time. You sacrifice your pleasures. You sacrifice your leave. So much you do sacrifice. I am really amazed to see the devotees sacrifice for the sadhus. Not only in Dublin, in every center I see. Wherever I have seen that center, I was in Durban, I was in Singapore, I was in other places like Ranchi, etc. I have seen how people sacrifice themselves for the purpose of the ashram. That is not easy, you know. Actually, we are doing so much of sacrifice, but then we are not aware that we are doing sacrifice. You know, you have your own time. You sacrifice that time and come and feed the sadhus and go. That means that sacrifice is not consciously done by you. So Sri Ramakrishna used to say to or Brahmananji, Rakhal, say, Rakhal, do everything consciously. And Rakhal Maharaj later used to advise his disciples. Do everything consciously means what? That I am doing a sacrifice, so it is a puja for me. In puja, what do? We sacrifice the flowers. We are giving one by one flowers we are offering. What is that? It is a yajna. It is a sacrifice. You are offering a lamp. You are offering a sacrifice. And you are doing sacrifice, everything. The whole puja is nothing but a sacrifice of different items. When you offer food items to Lord, what is that? The food items are sacrificed to that Lord. Everything you sacrifice. But the sacrifice concept, we do not keep it in mind. I am doing for the Lord is not there. Anyway, if you have that along with your service spirit, then what happens? It takes you spiritually to higher development. Otherwise, if you do only from the point of view of your self-sacrifice without connecting to God, then that becomes a very good social service. Every Saturday we have a Karma Yoga. So devotees come and clean the ashram. Okay. You are doing a social service if you do not attach it to the Lord. Social service is good, is welcomed, no problem. Nothing bad about that. But then it is not spiritually elevating you. So when you come to ashram and do some work, you should consider, I am doing this for the sake, as a sacrifice to Sri Ramakrishna. Then only that particular act becomes wonderful. Spiritually, it will strengthen you. Otherwise, yes, social service, okay. So this sacrifice spirit is for every noble soul, it is there. So Sri Ramakrishna also, it is true. How much sacrifice he has done. And he would go, if any devotees is sick and the news comes to Sri Ramakrishna, he would tell him, tomorrow, Sunday, you please take me to the devotee's house. I would like to go and see that person. All the way from Dakshineswar, at his, and he doesn't have proper good stomach. You know, Ramakrishna never had good stomach of digesting everything. Because of fasting, so much of fasting he did, his stomach got upset completely. And several times he had to run to that, you know, that is what is called that near there. What is that place is called?
Jautala.
Yes, Jautala. Near Jautala, he had to run several times. Why? Because his stomach was not okay. In spite of that, he would go by a cart. And then he would go there to that house and stay there, talk to him, and then come back. What a sacrifice of his time and energy, you see, for the devotees, how much he did. So this pranarpana, this sacrifice, what for he did? That is another question. For that, Swamiji is answering, Jagata Tarana. You have become Jagata Tarana because what is the meaning of Jagata Tarana? You are for the good of the world. You have given the world great many benefits, and this Jagat has been benefited by you. So this you did out of great sacrifice. Prana Arpana, you have given your life. That's why in Niveditas, if you go to Darjeeling and see Niveditas, grave, and it is written there, here rest Sister Nivedita, who gave her all to India. Nothing she kept with her. She gave her all to India. That's a great sacrifice. Because her guru, Swami Vivekananda, told her, sacrifice your life for the India's development. And she sacrificed her life. So likewise, you find sacrifice is a rule of law if you want to do some good and you want to develop spiritually. And Jagata Tarana, protection of the world or taking the world. This protection of the world also is two types, they say. How an incarnation protects the world? A particular crisis has happened in the earth. So to remove that crisis, God comes in the form of a human being. Say, for instance, the Ravanas, Ravana's presence and Ravana activities. Ravana has to be killed, so God has to come for Ram. A particular crisis, mind you, a specific crisis was there. So to remove that, he took incarnation. Now in Krishna's life, you see, Kansa. Kansa was such a notoriously bad, and all the deities went and called Lord Vishnu, please come and protect us. So he comes in the form of Krishna. So a particular crisis is removed, then he goes away. So the incarnation is over. That is one side. Another side is there, those who come into contact with him as his devotees, he imparts the spiritual knowledge. If you have got 10% of spiritual inclination by meeting a holy man, your spiritual inclination is increased. So many people say like that. They have felt it. I have also felt by sitting under the feet of a holy man how my inclination of spirituality increased multifold. So that provision or the providing that type of necessary increase in inclination, spiritual inclination, is another job of an incarnation. So that is very important, you know, point that we must understand there. So this, in Ramakrishna's case, was there any particular specific crisis that he came for? In order to kill Kans or in order to kill Ravana, is there any demon was there at that time, at the advent of Ramakrishna's time, whom he tried, he used lots of weapons and then killed them? No, you don't find any weapons used by Sri Ramakrishna. Rather, jokingly, our elders used to say his weapon was Namaskara weapon. This humility, that was his weapon. In Ranchi, one devotee was there. I think he's still there. He's an elderly person. He's called Biresh Babu. So when Biresh Babu comes to us, everybody says Namaste like this. So he will put his hands like that and he will do like this several times. So I used to ask him, is it an axe in your hand? Are you going to kill me with that? So he would do like that. So that humility, you know, humility can go to any extent. And when Sri Ramakrishna had such humility, you know, when Keshav Sen came, he was a great leader of Bengal, young Bengal, used to flock to him. That Keshav Sen comes and meets Paramahamsa. And then he looks at him and Sri Ramakrishna says, Namaste. Then Keshav Sen was compelled to raise his hands. Then Sri Ramakrishna bends his head. Then Keshav Sen was compelled to bend. Then he goes down on his knees. Keshav Sen also sat on his knees. Then he fell on the ground. So how he taught Keshav Sen, you know, how to do pranam. Most of us, we do not know how to do pranams. Can you imagine that? In Indian community itself, I'm telling you, they do not know how to do pranams. When they come, sometimes suddenly they come for the first time, they come to ashram. They look at Swami and said, hello, hi, how are you? Like that they say. They don't even say Namaste because they do not know. So at that time, what we do, we don't castigate them. We don't take any harsh words to them. We say Namaste to you, like that I do. So then they understand that, oh, Namaste has to be done. So you can teach them. So likewise, the humility is one of the astra, one of the weapons of Sri Ramakrishna, that he put everyone flat with this humility. Great, great people used to come. Can you think of Majumdar? Majumdar is a great professor in the Calcutta University at that time. He used to come and sit at his feet. Swamiji says in My Master, how the great intellectuals of Calcutta University used to come and sit at the feet of Master. Master is an illiterate person. Under him they sat and learnt. Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, he says, oh Lord, I have never heard such wonderful ideas that you are talking to me, he says. That great learned person. So you find that humility was his astra. So in this incarnation, the great Lord who came in the form of Sri Ramakrishna never used any weapon, because there was no asura to need that weapon. So he used the weapon of this humility. And then with that humility, he conquered the egos of the people. People's ego became very big when Sri Ramakrishna appeared on the scene. Everyone was holding such big ego. And when he came, he made everyone understand, no, don't keep this ego. Ego is Maya. First time in the history of the Vedanta, you will find this sentence in Sri Ramakrishna's gospel. Ego is Maya. What is Maya? The question was asked to him. He said, ego is Maya. You'll find it in the gospel. So to crash that ego, he came this time. Of course, the last one is Krintana Kalidora. I'll take up next week. Thank you, everyone. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Hari Om Tatsat. Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu. Durga, Durga.
Thank you, Maharaj. Pranam.
Maharaj, is it possible to get the recording of previous classes?
Pardon?
Is it possible to get the recording of the previous classes?
The recording is there. In the next week, I will give the link to all of you. You can go to that place. And then it is actually, it's understanding hymns like that. There is a YouTube channel. And that was created by Juma Majumdar, because under her sponsorship, this class is going on. So she has uploading every week, she uploads there. You can go there and listen to that. And Juma, please, next week you can give that link.
I'll share the link.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.